in order to be able to understand, for example, the short run hit that the economy is going to take during this period when we can't go to work, the most basic thing you might want to know is how many people, in fact, can work from home. How many people won't be able to work at all if they can't leave their home to go to a workplace. And so to answer this question, Jonathan Dingell and I looked at a number of survey questions administered by a group called ONET that tries to describe various characteristics of given occupations. So some of the questions would be, for example, do you operate heavy machinery? Or do you have to run during a typical day to conduct your job? And based on these survey responses, we can essentially classify any given occupation as an occupation that could be done from home versus an occupation where you really couldn't do it from home. You know, a police officer or a firefighter, for example, would be a very easy example where you couldn't really do that from home. Another example that you couldn't really do from home that's perhaps better because it would not be exempted from these stay-at-home orders, but would be, you know, certain kinds of commercial drivers, you know, or certain kinds of workers that need to be physically active. You know, classic examples coming up with restaurants, like a waiter can't really do their job from home. By contrast, for financial professionals, for a lot of service jobs, it's not such a big deal to do your work from home. And so Jonathan and I estimated that in the United States as a whole, 37% of all jobs could be done from home, could be done entirely from home. And it's worth noting that that's a much larger percentage of jobs than those that are currently done entirely from home. That leaves, of course, a very large set of workers that can't. And so that's very scary and problematic and suggests there's going to be, you know, a really severe economic hit from strong social distancing measures put in place to combat the health effects, of course, to protect the public health. Now, these 37% aren't the same as their complement. Those jobs that can be done from home typically are higher paid than those jobs that can't be done from home. So as much as 37% of the jobs can be done from home, they account for a larger set, 46% of all wages earned in the U.S. economy. So about 46% of wages is done by jobs that can be performed at home. Now, does that mean that, you know, wages or the economy is going to perform at a level equaling 46% with social distancing relative to what it was before social distancing? Of course not. There's a lot of elements that make it, you know, really difficult to map from our number to a, you know, sort of a guess or a forecast of GDP. You know, one thing that's important to note is that there's been a big demand shock, or there's likely a very big demand shock associated with this crisis. Furthermore, even taking as given just looking at the supply side, those jobs that are done at home, we have not evaluated whether when they're done at home, they're done with equal efficacy, with equal productivity as when they were done at work. And finally, it might be that various jobs can be done at home, but they're done less productively because when they're at work, they experience positive interactions, positive feedback, essentially, from interacting with other jobs that can't be done at home. So for all these reasons, we think our number is helpful, but more work would have to be done to translate them into an assessment of you know, what the actual hit to the economy will be from strong forms of social distancing. There's a lot of heterogeneity across cities and across industries in the share of jobs that could be done at home. For instance, you know, in some cities like San Francisco, a large share of the workers could in fact continue their work even under very strong forms of social distancing, where in other places like Las Vegas or Bakersfield, California, it's going to be much more difficult. This is one important to know just because it does imply that the effects of this crisis are going to hit very unevenly across households and regions, cities, and industries. But also we hope that being able to flesh this out, being able to provide these statistics, might be useful as policymakers try to target aid to those regions and occupations and industries and people that most need it. I should also mention that the heterogeneity that we describe not only exists within the United States across cities, but Jonathan and I are now in the early stages of looking at the equivalent statistic across various countries. And it's very early, but our work so far suggests that poorer countries, more emerging markets that aren't at the level of development of, let's say, the United States, typically have an even lower share of their jobs that can be performed at home. And so thinking globally about the impact of the COVID-19 crisis, our analysis does suggest that this might be an even harder challenge to keep workers going and doing what they used to do for emerging markets and poorer countries than in the rich world, where it's, of course, still a very large challenge.